We have official details on the 2022 Mazda MX-5 Miata. And while we didn't really get any styling updates, this actually might warrant the ND3 nomenclature. Over at the Mazda newsroom, we got pricing, packaging, and new features on the MX-5. The big takeaway is Mazda has developed a new technology called Kinematic Posture Control, which is interesting because I feel like Lexus has talked a lot about posture control with their future concepts, like their LF30 concept that's supposed to have solid state batteries. Anyways, Mazda looks to beat Lexus to the punch in terms of coining posture control with the new MX-5. It's supposed to give it better stability and cornering. It looks like they're really slimming down the automatic transmission availability on the new MX-5. That's fine with me. New platinum quartz metallic paint and terracotta Napa leather seats add more color options, which I was expecting some new paint and interior options. We get that. And the new MX-5 goes on sale with a starting MSRP of $27,300. No changes to the 2-liter Skyactiv G with 181 horsepower that was introduced in 2018 for the ND2 Miata, still the same 151 pound-feet of torque. And for 2022, the MX-5 Sport and Club models are exclusively paired with a 6-speed manual. Grand Touring, you can get either transmission. Kinematic Posture Control. This is the next step in that constant evolution of the Miata, offering an improvement in high G cornering precision and confidence. KPC is an all-new technology developed by Mazda that manages different vehicle systems to help the MX-5 behave as a harmonious extension of the driver's body without adding a single gram of weight. Okay, so they're not using adaptive dampers or anything fancy here, they're just using software. So KPC applies a very slight brake to the inner wheel during high G cornering. This is nothing new. It's new for the Miata though. And this pulls down on that corner, suppressing body roll and making steering response feel more linear through tight and rough corners. It also applies brake when you're accelerating through a corner, enhancing the limited slip effect. This KPC is really just enhancing the already existing limited slip differential that is in the MX-5 Club. So I can't wait to drive the new MX-5 to see if I can feel any differences. It does have significant body roll compared to, let's say, the GR86 and the BRZ. Heck, it even feels like it has more body roll than the new Civic Si that I just drove. So hopefully this new KPC system really minimizes that body roll and helps rotate the vehicle better, getting into the corner and is also leaving the corner. So on the base model, the Sport, you get the platinum quartz metallic in addition to all the other paint colors. We still don't have a touchscreen display, so typical Mazda there. Just a reminder, the Club has the Bilstein dampers, front shock tower brace, and the LSD we were talking about. But new for 22, the Club gets wireless CarPlay. Doesn't do anything for me as I have a Pixel, but that might be good news for some of you guys out there. Doesn't look like there are any changes with the Club with the Brembo BBS Recaro package. And for 22, the Grand Touring gets the all new terracotta Napa leather seats as an upgradable option to the standard black leather seats. The new terracotta Napa leather comes in at a $300 option. The most expensive MX-5 Grand Touring is at $35,500. And if you want the Club with the Brembo BBS Recaro package, still under $40,000, which is not really a big surprise here. Not a whole lot of change in the pricing. So visually, you're not going to be able to tell the difference between a 22 and a 21 unless you have the terracotta Napa leather on the Grand Touring model. But Grand Touring's nice and all. Not really a Grand Touring vehicle, in my opinion. It's a sport vehicle, and you got to get the Club package or the sport model. If you want to save a little bit of money, you get the sport model. But the Brembo BBS Recaro package makes the car just look so good. The kinematic posture control is going to be the differentiator here with the new model. Can't wait to drive it with this new system, as Mazda's tuned the braking system to assist with the cornering of the vehicle. But we have a lot of other news today. So over at the Global Toyota page, Toyota is weathering this storm, or seems to have weathered the chip supply storm already with the first month of January 2022. So what is happening is that they're expecting to produce 800,000 units in January 2022, which is going to help them hit the 9 million unit level for that fiscal year of 2021, for example. And at looking at last year in January 2021, or should I say this year? Anyways, when we get to the end of the year, the calendar year, things get a little bit fuzzy, right? But 740,000 units in January 2021. So they're outproducing that in the so-called chip supply shortage era. And if we multiply 800,000, assuming they're able to keep this pace for all of 2022, they're going to be producing nearly 10 million vehicles once again. And I expect them again to be the best-selling automaker volume-wise again in the world for 2022 fiscal year and calendar year probably. So definitely light at the end of the tunnel, it seems like, as a chip shortage, at least for Toyota, they're seeming to weather it fairly well. Unlike Subaru, remember how Subaru has kind of dropped the ball this year? Their sales are actually down compared to last year where the world stopped. Yeah, they're doing worse because Subaru recalls a chain breaking in what looks to be their transmission, and they're recalling 200,000 vehicles in the United States because a chain in the transmission can break. Huh, sounds like a CVT chain snapping. This covers 2020 Legacy Outbacks, as well as some 2019 and 20 Subaru Ascents. So to me, from the sounds of it, this sounds like the transmission only for the 2.4 liter turbo model. A programming error in the transmission control computer can let the clutch engage before the drive chain is clamped down. If that happens, the chain can slip and break, increasing the risk of a crash. Owners will be notified by mail starting February 7th. The remedy is expected to be in April. And this is on top of the Ascent recall that included a hydraulic sensor in the transmission. Yikes. Hopefully Subaru has some light at the end of the tunnel here, because it just goes from bad to worse. Hopefully they can get their production up. That's their number one task right now. Somehow shore up the chip supply and other parts, because it's not just the microchips. There are other Subaru parts that you just can't get for your vehicles right now. Lexus RZ450E. That was a trademark a while back. Gosh, over a year now, I think. Well, they've actually shown it on this teaser image. We got the full images of the RZ450E. If you missed that video, you've been living under a rock, because Lexus is going fully electric. But the RZ450E will be the first fully electric mass-produced Lexus for most markets. Direct 4, this is the first time we've seen the badge here for Direct 4. And this is the first time we'll ever see Direct 4 on a Lexus vehicle. So it'll be interesting to see if it drives any different from any other all-wheel drive Lexus, but it's definitely going to drive different. There's no transmission. It's an electric vehicle. There's no traditional transmission anyways. And yes, I'm expecting a little over 300 horsepower for the 0 to 60, around 5.5 seconds, but this might be one of the quietest luxury vehicles out there. Lexus has always been, you know, prided itself on high quality interior, really low NVH, and I'm expecting electrification to take that to the next level. So I feel like electrification and Lexus really go hand in hand, and now it allows them to actually pursue performance a little bit easier. So definitely a natural progression for Lexus, even though I know a lot of you guys want to see V8s, turbos, turbo V8s, but it's not going to happen. We're going fully electric, and I think Lexus has done its research here. Almost all of its competitors are going fully electric by the end of the decade, so they need to be in that same sort of market. And lastly, over at IC Cars, hottest new and used cars in November and year to date. So I'm not really interested in November that much. I'm more focused on the entire year so far. The Toyota Tacoma has been the fastest selling vehicle throughout the entire year on average. Now, I'm not counting Teslas because they don't sit on a lot. So we're just comparing apples to apples here for traditional automakers that their cars actually sit on lots. The Tacoma has been a fastest selling vehicle for 11 months, the Corvette for 10, Kia Telluride, doesn't surprise me, that's been a bestseller for 10 months, RAV4 Hybrid, Sienna is the new minivan hybrid, kind of like Escalade, been seeing a lot of them down here in Naples. RX450H, which kind of surprises me. Maybe their volume isn't that high, so not quite sure. I mean, it's better than the RX350, don't get me wrong, but it's not that much better. Anyways, Toyota 4Runner doesn't surprise me. Kia Carnival, minivans are really, really high end demand, so doesn't surprise me the Carnival's in there. IS350, that came out earlier this year, guns blazing with the new refresh, so that's been a really good selling vehicle for Lexus. GLS in there. Normal RAV4, RAV4 Prime. Isn't that funny? RAV4 takes up three of the fastest selling vehicles on this list. Pretty ridiculous. And then when we're talking about used cars, now we can bring Tesla into the mix, because of course they can be sold as a traditional used car. Anyways, that Model 3 is up there really, really high. People are spending tons of money on Model 3s in the secondhand market, way more than you would be spending on a brand new Model 3, because people don't want to wait 6 to 8 months to get their brand new Tesla. MX-5 is up there as well. Kia Telluride, people just can't get enough of it, new or used. Clarity plug-in hybrid, see one of those every day at my daughter's school. One of the other parents drives it. It's such a weird looking car. The Clarity's canceled as far as I'm aware, so they're not going to be the fastest selling vehicle for too long here. Honda Insight, though, will continue to be as gas prices skyrocket in many parts of the country. Palisade up there as well because the Telluride is the same vehicle essentially, it's just uglier. Mitsubishi Outlander. So maybe it was the fire sale on the old model, or maybe it's just that the new model is doing really, really well. It's kind of hard to say, but Mitsubishi's cash cow, their Outlander, doing well. Tesla Model X is in there as well as a Highlander hybrid. But guys, I'm going to there. If you enjoyed today's video, smash the like and subscribe for more Mazda news, updates, as well as all Japanese and Korean car updates. And I forgot to mention, there's also a lot of executive shuffling and people stepping down over at Hyundai right now. I'm not going to cover it too much until I learn more about it, if I feel like I want to cover it. But yeah, interesting things going on with the Koreans. But I'll see you guys down below. And as always, peace out.